The agenda is approved. All right, now we have a portion of the agenda for presentations. We have two presentations tonight, and we will begin with a presentation by Priscilla Lisicich, the Executive Director for Safe Streets for Community Engagement Award for National Night Out. Priscilla, welcome.
Thank you very much, Mayor Courts and council members and all your administrative staff. It's an honor to be here. You are people who are really committed to being engaged in your community. But about a year ago, you really set out on an adventure to broaden that engagement in a more formal way by developing the Community Connector program, which I am thrilled about, and I just see great things happening with that program through Chief Sheehan. And this evening, we want to recognize the City of DuPont, the Safe Streets campaign, which started in 1989, so we're 27 years old, and we actually started being an agent that helped to put on National Night Out 27 years ago throughout the community. This year, in DuPont, you had over 400 people turn out, which was fabulous. And Chief Sheehan told me he hoped that 50 people would do the walk for safety in the community. And it's reported, I wasn't able to be here, but you had 150 people. That's a real testament to the tight-knit community that you have and the level of support that people feel for their government here in DuPont. And that's really thrilling because this is where America, I think, really happens. It's right here at this grassroots level. So we have are presenting to you this evening for your commitment to positive resident involvement, the Safe Streets Community Engagement Award to the City of DuPont for your fabulous National Night Out party that was held on August 2nd, 2016. So, Mayor Court, I'd like to present you with this award and hope you'll proudly, prominently display. Thank
Chief,
you.
Come on.
You really test your gallery. Both chiefs, anybody with a first name chief.
And it isn't a conflict of interest, but the board president for Safe Streets is Chief Sheehan, so he's signing, his signature is on here.
Very good.
Thank you.
Oh, one of those things. We have it at a local and national level.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
We prominently display in our foster release. All right. That was a great event. Those continue to get better every year. And besides that, we had events going on in various villages throughout the city. So there were actually far more people than just those that showed up at Clock Tower Park. We appreciate that, and you know, particularly in a time when our nation has a lot of tension right now between law enforcement and citizens, to show that solidarity with our citizens and our law enforcement was a real tribute to what we have in our community. And for those of you who haven't seen them, we have blue lights now in DuPont, and Chief, I think they can still come by and get one from you guys. I just got my timer now, so now it automatically comes on at 8 in the evening and turns off at 6, so I don't have to remember to keep turning it on. Okay, next on the agenda is Advanced Life Support Briefing. This is, okay, no pun intended, but this is very near and dear to my heart. This is the beginning of a process, and how this process ends up is a very open-ended at this time, but for the citizens that have been here a while, there have been a few attempts in the past to go down this road, and those have not been successful, but I think a lot of lessons have been learned. And as your mayor, and as members of the council, members of the staff, some of the lessons that were taken away were be very clear, be very specific, be very transparent. Funds have to be directly accountable her purpose, and I think those messages have been well received. And I'm excited about the process we're going to embark on and what that will look like. So, okay. So a lot of reasons you might need advanced life support. Not all of them have to do with a heart attack. Okay, we have a couple different types of first response. The first one is basic life support. That's what we have in DuPont right now. And you can see by the bullets, we have emergency medical technicians, EMTs. And they have good but limited capabilities. They can do initial clearing of airway. There is epinephrine that they can administer for allergic reactions. Very, very limited in what they can give for medications. No intubations. And they can do advanced CPR. And they can use the automatic external defibrillator. And there's no minimum crew requirements with an organization that has BLS. Advanced life support, and that's where we're talking about. Everything that BLS can do, plus they must have a minimum of 2 fully trained personnel. One of them must be a paramedic. You'll see some more details later, but a typical crew would be 4. And the paramedics, extensive training, both classroom and practical training, and pretty extensive requirements to maintain currency. They can establish IVs. They have a much broader range of medications that they can give. They can intubate, and they can use defibrillators. The equipment requirements are significantly higher than BLS. Okay, so we only have the BLS. Oh, let me turn this over. Where are you? There you are. Okay.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As stated in the earlier slide, DuPont only does have emergency medical technicians at basic life support. Not having an ALS service delivery, it does add stress to the firefighter response. You may have an EMT responding to an advanced life support call and have a limited scope of practice. That is only exacerbated if the paramedic car is not available to come to DuPont. We'll talk about that a little bit later on the numbers of times that they come and cannot come. And when that does happen, we'll re-interface treating a patient as EMTs that is advanced life support criteria that we don't have the paramedic. We transport to the closest hospital. That's either St. Clair, Madigan, in some cases St. Peter's Hospital in Olympia. You know, so we do try to have 4 people on duty at all times, and one of those 4 is a reserve firefighter or reserve EMT. They do have full-time jobs, many of those folks, and they have families and commitments elsewhere, so their availability is not as great as you would typically find with some of us in the station on duty 24 hours a day. There's times that we drop down to 2, and that's very rare, and that would be if we do have the 4th person on and they're transporting the patient to the hospital, the engine will come back and you're being in service with 2 people. But we typically have 3 people on duty at all times within the city. And at times, sometimes I am that 3rd person during the daytime hours. And that was done with an agreement with the firefighters union. As stated, our ambulance is not equipped for advanced care. We have an AED, we have a LifePak 15, but there's some other equipment that we would have to buy if we get approval to go with paramedics. The cost, because of the ERR fund that we currently have funded pretty adequately over the last several years, has given us the ability to have the funds needed to buy an ambulance that has the space necessary to store the extra equipment that would be needed for a paramedic unit. And also, it's needed replacement anyhow because of the age of the vehicle. Our transports, we transport most of our BLS patients to the hospital. And again, we are very close to 3 hospitals, so we are fortunate in that case. We do transport advanced life support patients when the private ambulance is not available at paramedic. And when we get a little further in the presentation, you'll see the numbers of times that they have not been available. We talk about ALS calls. They typically require 4 people. 9 is the best. If we can get in the middle of that, between 6 or 7 responders, that would make the care for advanced life support patients much easier. much more efficient and effective as we respond to these calls. It's not just a cardiac arrest, it's severe respiratory problems, allergic reactions. It could be a trauma patient, someone who's fallen that needs to be placed on the backboard. But on a CPR call, one person needs to be responsible for the scene safety, dealing with the patient's family, getting medical history, coordinating care, and really watching the crew to make sure the quality of CPR is maintained throughout the entire treatment of the patient. So if you have four people, two people on compressions, the American Heart Association recommends that we rotate every 2 minutes. CPR is pretty physical as the person doing it. It's 100 times a minute you're doing compressions. And over 2 minutes, it becomes less effective as the person doing it, so they're recommending the changes every 2 minutes. One person's in charge of respirations. They're using a bag valve mask and breathing for the patient. They're taking care of the airway with suctioning, getting secretions out of the airway to make sure that they have good respirations going in. They are, and one of those four people is going to be operating medical equipment, such as the AED. And that's the defibrillator. It's just, we have to get the pads in place. We have to have someone that's watching that and monitoring it, making sure the crew is operating safely. Most Pierce County departments send two engine companies, a paramedic, and a battalion chief officer to CPR calls because of the rotation. And there's a slight commitment that you'll see some of the jobs that are in place. And this one here is a cardiac arrest, most likely due to drowning. And Los Angeles Fire Department got this picture just to demonstrate the numbers of people and what the jobs are doing. Los Angeles Fire Department's lifeguards are part of the fire department. It's a division of their service. And I'm going to start with number nine first. And number nine, probably looking at this, is probably the supervisor lifeguard crew. They're incident commander. They're watching quality control of the entire incident, making sure the scene is safe. They might be getting information from someone who witnessed the event. Number eight is holding the bag valve mask. They're getting ready to start ventilating the patient. They're hooking the bag valve mask up to an oxygen cylinder. They're probably taking care of anything with the airway, so that would be suctioning the patient if they need to be suctioned at all. A little out of order here, but number seven and number five and number two all dedicated to patient compressions, and they're going to rotate out on a 2 minute basis. Number six is the paramedic, and he's intubating the patient. Number four, sorry, covering number five, is also a paramedic. They're most likely starting IVs and giving intravenous drugs for the event that patient is experiencing. So you can see nine people. It's intense, and the window of opportunity that we have is, you know, on scene time, 20 minutes. You go to that we're going to operate on scene and transport. But if you go to the emergency room, just think your time when you get there, the time that you get released or admitted to a floor, how many people you see during that time. We do that in 15 to 20 minutes. Here's another procedure on an ALS patient that was entrapped in a vehicle accident. And this is a crew of six. And what's not in this picture is what's happening outside that inner circle of treatment. And again, I'll start with number six. Airway management, probably intubating the patient, taking care of the secretions that the patient would have in their airway. Number five is maintaining C-spine mobilization to make sure their neck does not move during the treatment and extrication of the patient. Numbers three, four, and five are there as staffing to get that patient onto the backboard safely. Once the backboard is in place, they get the patient on the backboard, they're going to work on strapping the patient down on the backboard and securing them to make sure they don't move at all. And number one could serve as the incident commander overall scene safety. They're also assisting with the paramedic with intubations, handing them equipment, and most likely handing them any kind of medications the patient would need during that treatment. And outside that picture, when we took that accident scene, now we just go out to an outer circle. There's additional people that are on that scene. You have someone on the hose line, and anytime there's an MVA or motor vehicle accident, we want to at least have a fire extinguisher out there to take care of any potential fire problems. That's the best practice, having a hose line in place, because it gives us the ability to use firefighting foam and gets the ability to extinguish fires pretty quick. Also that, you have your backboard crew here. This individual is in charge of the rescue operation, directing the patient extrication. They've already come up with different plans of extricating the patient, both their plan A, B, and C, in case one plan isn't successful, they'll move on to plan B. And you have an incident commander that's watching the incident, accounting for all the scene safety, and managing additional resources that are coming in to the incident. So our current response right now comes from Falk Ambulance. They're a contractor that is in Pierce County. They have paramedics. Rural Metro, we get them rarely. We used to have American Medical Response, AMR, but they have moved out of the county due to a business decision that they've made. The number there says 42% of the time, but in July, that number is 33% of the time that they were not available to come to DuPont. And the numbers down there, those aren't updated. Those were in seconds. So this year, our response time for DuPont Fire is 339 seconds after response time from the time of call to the time of arrival. Our ALS arrival time is over 15 minutes. And again, they're not available as of July, 33% of the time. The 15 minutes doesn't account for the time of dispatch to the time they get on the air, because our dispatch system doesn't capture them because they're dispatched to their own dispatch center. But our 339 seconds is a complete time from time of call to time of arrival.
Right, so if we go down this process, getting ALS and DuPont, these are the steps we're gonna take. Beginning tonight and continuing throughout September, community discussion on the current EMS state and process to examine ALS, and that's what you're seeing right now. I've already sent letters out. We're assembling an expert task force. We'll cover that in a little more detail shortly. This task force will examine DuPont's requirements, various ways that we could achieve ALS, look at some of the costing involved in it, and that task force will meet in public several times. Anytime they meet, it will be available for people to go watch, observe. That task force will report back to me. I will then take those findings and conduct community meetings open for comment. The idea being, we want to hear from the citizens of DuPont how you feel about ALS, what you think about the recommendations of the task force. And based on that, I will take the task force and community input back to the council, provide it to your council, and then the council ultimately is going to decide the way ahead. Are we going to do anything? Are we going to pursue one of the courses of action? Are we going to pursue a different course of action? And then ultimately, if a course of action is decided, then there's a strong chance it comes back to the citizens for a vote. We intend to do this very methodically, keep it in the open, and make sure that everybody's comfortable with the process. This is the task force we're looking at. Total between 5 and 7 experts on the subject. Chief Creekmore will serve on it. We're still looking for an outside chief or EMS chief. We've got a few different calls out to people. The head of our fire union, John Roberts, will be there. I've asked Lee Chase, who's here with us tonight, and our former DuPont fire chief, to serve on it. We have a Pierce County paramedic, Mr. Nate Jean. I've asked Mike Winkler, who's also here with us tonight, and although I don't think Mike is an expert on ALS, what Mike is an expert on, has done several times in the past, is public funding. And we think his expertise throughout this process is very important, because you could end up with a ballot measure, and that's got to be considered as part of it. This isn't a citizens committee, but the DuPont residents will be on it, and the results of this will be under the scrutiny of the citizens of DuPont. This is what we're looking for. We want to look at different models, and these are not necessarily inclusive of all the options, but these are what we've tossed out there. Obviously, doing nothing is always a course of action. The second bullet, growing into it over time, there are some barriers associated with the law associated with that, but that will be something the task force can look at. We could grow it ourselves, and DuPont Fire Department provides it. We could contract, public or private, to provide it. We could abandon the DuPont Fire Department and annex into a district, or we could consider an EMS district or utility. All of those are models that are pursued somewhere out there in the world, and so we've asked this task force to look at all of those, consider them. We've asked them to produce a report and then recommend us course of action and potentially alternatives. This timeline we're looking at for this action, it's been under development actually for several months. Kickoff brief, we talked with some council members yesterday. Tonight, the entire council's getting it. We are assembling the ALS task force right now. And then in September, we're gonna have three different meetings, one day, one night, and then one on a weekend. And we will put those out broadly so that if you wanna participate, come sit in on those. This is basically this presentation again. The purpose of that is to inform the public of the process. The ALS task force will then meet throughout September and have their discussion in public. We're looking at three meetings, and then on that fourth week, they bring it back to me with a recommendation, and then we're looking at two opportunities in the month of October to take that task force recommendation back to the public in hearings, let the public make comment on it, and then in that fourth week of October, I will bring the results of both the task force recommendations and the input from the public back to the council. The council will then take the action, and they will decide how they want to proceed. They may have more public hearings. They may want more time to debate. If, in fact, the decision is to go forward with a ballot measure, then we have two windows of opportunity. We could bring in February vote, or we could bring in April vote. And that will very much be a council decision how they want to proceed with that. But this is the sketch of how we intend to pursue this process. We look forward to as many people as possible being involved in it. I feel strongly that ALS is a service that we owe the citizens of DuPont. This is not a threat briefing. If the answer is no, we're not losing any of our current service. So the worst case of service level is that we have what we have right now. But as you see by the time, there is a significant difference between when our organic basic life support that we have in the DuPont Fire Department arrives on the scene and when ALS, which comes from somewhere out of DuPont, arrives. And we have seen that availability decrease over time as business decisions were made by private providers. And that's one of the issues that we have to address. Council, I would like to offer it to you for any questions now. And for members of the audience, if you have questions on this, you can contact me, Chief Creekmore, Firefighter John Roberts, or the City Administrator Ted Danning. Council, if you don't have any questions, you know the process we're going to be on. We can provide you hard copies of this. Yeah, absolutely.
I just need to make that one chart time that the chief was talking about. I'm not a firefighter. They got seconds and minutes going on. I need to make sure those are correct when I get that updated tomorrow. I won't be here tomorrow, but Thursday I should have this file out to you guys.
Okay, Councilmember Hilbert.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Ted, if we could go back to slide four, I believe it was slide four. Not that far back. Let's try the next one here. I was looking at the old copy. Okay, there we go. Thanks. Chief Creekmore, if you could just talk to us for a sec about this patient outcomes, the patient care piece, and how a stressful situation like in ALS, that warrants ALS, how rehearsals factor in, how an integrated crew that knows each other, knows how to work with one another, could actually have a serious effect. If you could just hear how, from your perspective or from a firefighter's perspective.
Yeah, I'll talk briefly about it and then turn it over to Captain Strasba. When you have a crew that works together, you kind of anticipate one another's moves. They work much better together. Patient care or any task they're doing just much smoother. And it does affect patient care to kind of anticipate, be able to work through how that crew will move and rotate during evolution, even it's mentioned that, you know, in the morning that crew gets together and they'll talk about calls that they can encounter that day. On a drop to a call, they might do a quick, what are three possibilities? So they start thinking, when you're separated from your crew and you're not working with them, that teamwork isn't there, the creativeness on the way to the call isn't there, the awareness of what you could be walking into isn't there. We have that luxury because we work with one another and we can anticipate each other's moves. On the outcome of patient, you know, that's something we may never know, but we know that we want to give every patient in the city of DuPont the best possibility for the most positive outcome of the care that we provide, whether that's BLS and hopefully potentially provide advanced life support to this community.
Thank you.
My home here. Hi, Captain Strasbaugh. So, like Chief was saying, it really comes down to we want to provide the best outcome possible. And our job is to go to a stranger's house and help them mitigate whatever emergency they might be having at that time. And to them, that's a significant emergency, whether it's, you know, they didn't know what time church started on Sunday or they are having a legitimate CPR event. Some of the events that we go on, they don't require that many people, but majority of them do. And it's the ones that that we're really hoping to have a good outcome on. Those are the ones where we need the more people. Those are the ones where a lot of work is going to be done, and we're going to do whatever we can to get it done with however many people we have. But we know, at the end of the day, there are options in place that would allow us to provide better service for our citizens here in DuPont. And mind you, I'm not speaking just as an employee here. I have a sister, I have a nephew, I have friends that I've grown up, they all live in this community, so this community is very important to me too.
And so, if you're having a private carrier come in, for instance, that's arriving on the scene that you are at providing BLS, what's it like integrating in a private carrier versus one that's in-house? How's that communication usually work on scene?
Well, it's unique, and it's unique in the sense that it starts once we roll out the door. On our way to the call, the first thing we're wondering, generally, is do we have a private in route with us? As an officer, I need to know that so I can start figuring out what my plan of action is going to be. If it's going to be we don't have one, and this is a legit ALS call, what am I going to do? Am I going to try to call one of our neighbors and see if they want to help? They're not obligated to. They can come help if they want to. There's only so many times you can use up that option too. And then once you get on the call and once the private ambulance shows up, over time you build a little bit of rapport with a few of them and you kind of know what to expect. But for the most part, the brand new faces we see every single time. So I don't know what to expect out of them. You know, these are our incidents. This isn't DuPont. This is what we're tasked with, is to take care of our citizens. And I'll tell you right now, honestly, there are certain people that show up and take care of our citizens that I would not put my family member in the back of the rig. That's just bold speak for me.
Thanks.
Councilmember Gorski.
Yeah, I'd like to see a few pieces of information provided, and a lot of it goes around the cost of capital that would have to support a changeover from BLS to ALS. What is capital investment? What is a consumable? What's the adder to our budget annually for consumables? And then that's outside of the personnel changes. And I want us to be clear on that. And a few years back also, we did have some data that we were kind of taking a look at on what is an ALS, BLS call rate in DuPont and trying to get our arms around that. So I saw a lot of no data there. I'm not sure why there's so much no data when we do have a logging system, a way of ranking these calls, because some may turn out as an initial ALS, but you get there and it turns out to not be the ALS call that we thought. I want to touch further on what is our statute, what are we able to charge for an ALS run versus a BLS run? Does that change? So if we go and upgrade the system in the city that we go on an ALS run, is that what we bill back? Does that change? And how much are we allowed by law if at all, to change that. Those are questions I would want answered. And the last one, for as far as calls are concerned, how many of the call volumes are coming out of the Patriots Landing facility? Because they do have professional medical staff available, are they intubating? Are they dropping IVs? Or are they unable to do that prior to transport? And that's why, you know, ALS would take over. Because I want us to have a full picture of the percentage of the burden and where it comes from, and that we're appropriately billing back those who use the services if we upgrade to ALS. So, and then there is one point that I have to take a little bit of umbrage to. When you say we owe it to the citizens will decide. We're not Santa Claus and we give gifts back to the citizens. It's their money. And so they will decide through a vote on whether or not they want the service. So we're here to give them a transparent process, boatloads of data, and very clear and honest financials on what it would cost and various mechanisms. So I just recoil and say we're here to give something to the citizens like a gift. It's not the case. If the citizens want this, they won't vote for this, and I'm happy to support that. But I will say I'm a little bit troubled. I do not like at all non-November elections to raise taxes. It is a personal thing with me. When you go in February and you go into April, you've got a very low turnout historically. You can verify this with the Pierce County Elections Offices. And this is, in a way, to hammer through a tax increase. So it's been very clear that we are going, if we're going to go down this route and raise money in an off season, I would like to see a full court press from everyone involved who's pro side to get a tremendous amount of vote out, because if you come back with a 25 or 35% vote passing a substantial tax increase, people are going to start, you know, crying shenanigans and other things. So just prepare yourself when you go to an off election and you're going to get a tax increase on a ballot. And a lot of organizations and municipalities do this, so be aware that if you're coming in under 40%, you're going to have people screaming that you raise taxes without the voice of the true voice of the people. So, and I understand that you're not going to vote on elections, but just be clear that that's waiting for you if you try that route and it comes out to be low. So just fair warning, I'm not saying good, bad, or indifferent. I'm telling you my point of view on that. So, but those are the things I'd like to see before that kind of information come back, and come back outside of the schedule so that we're getting that information pumped in as the community groups and the expert tax forces are receiving this data themselves. I'd like to see updates come to us in real time and not as some packaged event like a PowerPoint.
Yeah, and just a couple responses for you, Councilmember Worski. The law requires us to have a minimum of 40% of the most recent November vote in order to pass anything, and you have to have a 60% vote of that 40%. So I understand that, and that is one of the discussions, a off-cycle. And if I misrepresented myself, I think we owe the citizens the opportunity to decide. It's a service that's important, but you're right, they'll decide. And we deliberately stayed away from any costing point numbers at this point in time, because that was not the intent of this piece. There will be a volume of data. I absolutely agree with you, full, holistic, total cost, not just to stand up and personnel, but sustain it. I absolutely agree with all those points. Councilmember Russell.
Yes, Chief, would you explain how the services of a medical doctor would be used in an ALS call?
You know, if we do get paramedics, we do need a doctor. That would be our physician for the city that would write prescriptions for the controlled drugs. They also conduct base HIVs with paramedics, ensure quality control. They help supervise and manage the training of the paramedics. So that would be part of the cost of a program, that you'd have to have that person either contracted or utilize another one from another department to see if the cost would be diminished because you know, it's scale economy.
Councilmember Cassidy.
Yes, other than a cardiac emergency, could you give us another example of where ALS would be beneficial versus what we currently have?
Yeah, anything that's dealing with extreme pain where the patient needs pain medication, we can't give that pain medication. So you got a patient that is waiting for a paramedic to arrive, that would be, well, you've all probably been to the doctor, they ask you what your pain scale is.
You get a patient that's 8 over 10 or 10 over 10, and that's BLS coming to oxygen. So a paramedic will be able to help them with the pain tolerance level and give them medication to that, which could also decrease their stress level, decrease their blood pressure. Because if they're in that pain long enough, if they have any medical history, they could go into a cardiac problem. They also treat diabetic emergencies. Someone with low blood sugar or high blood sugar, they can treat extreme respiratory emergencies. You get someone with respiratory distress on the extreme scale, they give them epinephrine, they can give them albuterol treatments, which is a breathing treatment that they hook up to an oxygen mask. If you can get a patient that's breathing so hard and so fast that they physically just get tired and they shut down respiratory and they become in respiratory rest, then we have to breathe for them. They can do a ton more things with the life pack. They can do cardioversion. They can do a pacemaker on a patient. All we can do is just operate the AED portion of it.
One more question. I understand that we don't currently have a paramedic on staff. Is there, of our existing staff, is there a firefighter who would be interested in becoming a paramedic if that option were available?
Yes, several have voiced that they would like to attend paramedic school and be able to serve the community in that capacity.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, seeing no more questions. Chief, gentlemen, thank you very much. Appreciate it for the public. We're excited about beginning this process. It's open-ended. We hope you'll be involved with us on this journey. Between the council and the public, that'll be a decision that's made if the course of action is pursued. And then again, the citizens decide to adopt it. Okay, next on our agenda is our first opportunity for public comments. If you would like to speak to anything on or off the agenda, please come to the podium, state your name, address, and then limit your comments to 3 minutes, please.
Hey, Buster, Joanne, Randy-Mine. I'm going to make my public comment early versus later after the Parks Recreation report because I want to make sure that citizens out there on the broadcast know about the September Parks Rec event coming up, the September 16th Home Walk at College Creek. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no more public comments, we'll move to the consent agenda. Motion would be in order for approval of the consent agenda. We have a motion by Councilmember Helder, a second by Councilmember Gorski. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of approving consent agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Consent agenda is approved. Thank you, Council. Okay, tonight's discussion item is the 2017 Lodging Tax Advisory Committee grant funding recommendations, and I will turn it over to our finance director, Mr. who will be aptly assisted by Deputy Mayor Councilmember Roger Lewis.
Good afternoon, Councilmember Mayor. Today I bring forth to you the recommendations from the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee for the 2017 grants. I have a PowerPoint that's going in the background, so hopefully I can keep in check with that. But the purpose of this is to go over what the LTAC committee is recommending for funding for grants for 2017. Tonight there'll be no action to take. What will happen is on September 13th, I'll come forth with a resolution for based on the recommendations from the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee for your approval. Lodging Tax Advisory Committee actually had 27 different grant applications totaling over $350,000 that they reviewed. During that time, they were looking at the guidelines for reviewing the lodging tax applications, and those guidelines include that expenditures must be used only for activities or operations designed for exclusively to increase tourism and for capital expenditures related to municipal and tourism-related facilities. When you talk about marketing tourism marketing, that's looking at the advertising, the publicizing, and otherwise distributing information for the purpose of attracting people to come here to our fine city. And it's also to be used for designing strategies in order to encourage people to come to our city. The operating expenditures related to tourism would include special events and festivals that would bring people here to our town, and also operations and capital expenditures related to tourism facilities that are owned or by a municipality or public facilities district. So with all of those, that criteria in mind, the committee had actually reviewed the grants and came up with a variety of applicants and organizations who would actually receive the funding. And that list is right there for you on the screen. What I'm going to do is kind of go through each of the grants that were approved and the funding levels that were approved for each of those grants, or at least recommended, not approved, excuse me. The first one is the Tourism Department salaries, benefits, and supplies. The committee is recommending funding the $96,000 that would cover the cost of oversight and management of the tourism program, and that would include the salaries, the benefits, and the related operating supplies. In addition, LTAC looked at a variety of events to support over the next year. With those events are related overtime costs that are impacting the city's city staff. And so with all of the events that were recommended by the LTAC committee, they also recommended the overtime that would go to the city to be able to support those events that they are recommending. The city had actually requested $35,000 for events that would be put on in the city, but based on the selection criteria, $15,290 is recommended to be approved.
And as the next slide comes in, I might just add, that's the big reductions for two reasons. The biggest is other programs that would have gotten overtime were cut or reduced, so the commensurate overtime was reduced. And the second is, you know, I feel very strongly personally and professionally that when especially outside agencies come in and have events and use our resources as they're getting money from LTAC, which is what it's for, then you know the direct cost of the city should be recouped where possible. So this is really the first time that we put a big ask in for all the associated overtime. Before, it was scattered and you know, police and fire and public works ordered one of all these support missions they had to do. So I would just say I'm thankful that LTAC considered this and gave us enough overtime to cover all these great events that happened.
All right. The Washington Junior Golf Association put in a request for $18,100 to help put on the Washington Juniors America Cup. And this competition brings players from over Western Washington, the Western U.S., Mexico, and Vancouver, B.C. And those funds would be used to enhance the experience of those that are coming here to participate in that event. The home course is also put in a request for this event as well. And the request was for $16,500, and it is recommended that $15,000 of that be funded. The tourism department does a tremendous amount of advertising for events that are going on within the city to bring people in. And there was a request for $25,000 to be able to do that advertising. The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending funding that at $14,000. The Classic Glass Corvette Club put in a request for $9,000 for their car show that would take place during the Hudson Bay Heritage Days event. And the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending funding of the $400,000 ask that they had. Also taking place on the Hudson Bay Heritage Day weekend is the Kansas City Barbecue Competition. And this American Legion put in a request for $7,500 to help sponsor that event. And the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending that that be funded at the $7,500. The Parks and Recs Department has traditionally put on a golf tournament that took place on Hudson Bay weekend. If I can get that out. The Parks and Rec Department has put in a request for what is now called the Mayor's Cup, and that would be a golf tournament, which would bring in teams of four people who would come in and actually compete for the Mayor's Cup. The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee did recommend that be funded at $5,000, which was the requested amount for that activity.
You didn't state that the deputy mayors have to caddy for the mayors.
You ready, Roger?
Whatever.
The Tourism Department did put in a request to be able to put welcome baskets or bags together for when large groups come to the city of DuPont. And part of the ask for this and desire of the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee would be to come up with a signature item to be able to include in these baskets that would remind people of DuPont. And the request that came out was for $5,000, but the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending a $3,000 funding level for that. The Hudson Bay Heritage Days is a huge event there's many activities that are going on during that weekend. And so the Tourism Department was looking for a $6,000 ask to be able to fund the advertising for that event. There's a lot of things that are going on that weekend. The LTAC committee is recommending that $2,500 be funded for the advertising for that weekend. The DuPont Historical Society put in an application for a heritage tent to put up during the Hudson Bay Heritage Day events. They had requested $5,000. The LTAC committee is recommending $2,000. That money would be used to contract an event coordinator to help oversee the Heritage Day tent activity and put on that event. Wear Blue Run to Remember requested $4,000 for their event. Their annual event continues to bring in more and more people to DuPont. The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending $2,000 to go towards the promotion of the run to advertise out beyond the 50 miles. The Home Course is putting on a Tournament of Champions and has recommended requested $4,000 to help pay the green fees for the participants of that event. The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee is recommending funding that at $1,000. Then the Historical Society put in a request for $1,000 for their Cherry Blossom Tea event. That event has grown to over 200 participants in 2016.
So the LTAC committee is recommending funding of $1,000 for that grant as well. We are almost through the list. This was a lot for the committee to go over. So I've got two more left. And the next one is the freeway sign annual fee for the museum and historical district sign that is out on the freeway. The LTAC committee is recommending $455 for the annual fee for that sign, which is the actual cost of that. And then finally, the Shamrock Walk. They had put in a request for $1,500, and the LTAC committee is recommending funding at $300. When it came to, I'll go back to the questions in a moment, but I thought it would be good to at least talk about the funding level and how that was established. And if you, we're at my page, sorry. If you look on page 48 of 90, you'll see that the proposed budget is there, in which you're going to see revenues for hotel motel tax at about $173,000. Though that revenue is up substantially compared to last year, we have two new hotels that are coming into the city of DuPont, which will nearly double our room availability stay here in DuPont and provide the potential of doubling our revenue for hotel motel tax. However, that being said, and me being the conservative accountant I am, I only budgeted a 30% increase in revenues for next year, just to see how things go, and not trying to be too overly optimistic, even though I'd like to be personally. On the financial scale, I hate to commit money that I haven't seen trends yet. So walking into that, we're looking at a 30% increase in revenues for hotel motel tax. The grants recommendation by the LTAC committee would equal $189,108. You add that to the administrative costs for managing the LTAC meetings and minutes and budget and all of that of $3,000 would give expenditures of $192,000. That is, the expenditures that are being proposed are larger than the revenues that are expected to come in, or at least being budgeted to come in. However, that being said, when we look at the 2016 budget and estimated actuals, revenues related to the hotel motel tax are coming in at a faster rate than we had budgeted. And I did give an estimated actual for revenues of $136,000, and I do believe that that is low. Again, trying to take a conservative approach to this. In addition, the grants that were awarded were anticipating about $15,000 or $16,000 of underspending with the grants that have been awarded for this year, which would leave a carryover balance of nearly $20,000 to offset the additional expenditure that you would see there.
And as we get ready to turn this over for questions and discussion, a little bit on process, a quick reminder, I think all of you know this, but it bears repeating. Washington state law only allows you to accept the individual funding levels or reject them. So you can't add to the amount, but you can't subtract from it. You can either say, yes, we take your recommendation in full, or you get rid of it in full. So it's kind of an all or nothing by event. The second thing I wanted to explain a little bit about the process. First of all, was that not clear? It wasn't clear. So it's all or none. So let's take, for instance, the Shamrock Walk was 300. You can't say, well, we're going to make it 400, and you can't say, we're reducing it down to 200. You can either say, yes, the Shamrock Walk had 300, or you can say they had zero.
Can you talk about the differential I see here, though? If it's requested 18,100, approved 15,000, how is that in keeping with what you're saying?
That is at the LTAC committee. They have the authority under state law to go ahead and adjust requests. So they set the recommendation, the legal recommendation. It is your job to take that recommendation or reject it. So part of the process before we get into questions, I'm sorry. I wanted to thank the LTAC committee. They put in probably, just to get this product to you,
pushing on 15 to 20 hours of long, hard meetings. There were a lot of applicants. They had the applicants come in for the first time and give presentations. And so my thanks to them for doing that. And they had a very, very rigorous process of going through this. And you can see that in your packet, they have some groups who weren't ready to explain their finances or explain their activity to come back later. Thanks.
Are you ready for questions now?
I'd like to make a call.
Okay, go ahead.
You good? I'm on.
Yeah, no, you're not.
I'm on a second.
Okay, now you're on.
I want to thank the LTAC committee members. We did meet on August the 10th at 9 o'clock in the morning in order to consider each and every applicant. And we did not adjourn until 2:18 in the afternoon. We took our job very, very seriously. We analyzed every application in reference to the RCW that governs how these lodging tax could be distributed. Council, you need to, when you take official action when this comes before you, if you wish to eliminate a particular item, that is your prerogative. By zero funding, that in effect means that, hey, that is off the roster for 2017. As Ted indicated, you cannot lower nor can you increase the amount because that is within the authority of LTAC to make that determination and has that recommendation to you. I want to make it perfectly clear that if the council decides to eliminate and put zero amount, meaning you're not going to fund that activity, we on the LTAC will not take that as a personal insult and slam to our decision. It's your decision to make. So please feel free to act upon these. And I would suggest that if there's going to be an elimination to zero, that a vote be taken by council on each individual item if there's going to be zero funding. And we will not be offended by that. That is your decision. I want to assure you that we went through and analyzed and looked at every one of these. We presented questions, and to us, this is our best recommendation to you for your ultimate action when it comes time for final decision. Thank you.
Councilmember Gasser.
Going through this list, I was really surprised. I looked and only one request from Parks and Rec was approved, and it was for approximately 20% of what they actually requested, except for the golf-related items, I was going to say. Every golf-related item was approved. Looking through here, but nothing else from Parks and Rec, except the Shamrock Walk for $300. So I found that really disappointing. I'm especially struggling with the idea of assisting with lost revenue for the home course.
I'll clear that up. That's not happening. We talked to the applicant, explained that could not happen, and that's just something that got out there. That is an inappropriate use of LTAC money will not be occurring.
And I see there's another new event on here that coincides with Hudson Bay Days, and I think we have a lot going on. Do we really need to add something else to that? Can we coincide it with something else or make it its own event? That seems like a lot to me. My other question is, I would like more details on this Junior America's Cup because you've got two items, one requested by the Golf Association and one by the home course. The home course request here, it's not broken out, it just says the above, so I'd like more details on that. And the comment I'm seeing a lot that I want defined is...
deferred?
No, it was something about outward, like basically implying that it's not going to bring people from the outside in. I think it was the, let me find it here. Outward focus, less outward focused. And the, that was even said about the Seahawks event and the garage sale, which I thought didn't make a lot of sense. Can you define that for me?
Yeah, the lodging tax advisory committee felt as though when you talk about the outward focus, they're looking at people who would travel more than 50 miles to come into the city of DuPont. Because lodging tax dollars, when we report back to the state, we're reporting on how many people come and stay either in hotels or with others here in DuPont for these events, and how many people are traveling more than 50 miles or from out of state. So when they use the term outward focus, they're talking about an event that isn't really focused specifically, drawing mostly people that surround us in our neighboring cities, but are surrounding us much further out than just localized.
So 50 miles.
Correct.
Outward focus.
Correct.
I know that we're all about promoting the park's history and golf and the trails, but I feel like this is screaming golf to me. I don't see much else going on. And
Councilmember Gorski.
Well, since I got knocked out of the first of the queue and I'm going third again, I was going to say the same thing about the lost revenue for the home course. That is just outrageous, and we would never want to support that as a council.
Again, let me stress.
But it is in this packet, and this packet is online.
So understood. That's why I'm very forceful. The applicants didn't know the laws when they came in person. We verbally instructed them that couldn't be. They explained what it was, and it does meet the criteria for the use of LTAC money.
Right, because I want to remind the citizens, when they have a tournament, we lose money. Because, not because of, you know, the overtime that we have incurred in the past, but we get, I believe, an entrance fee we lose, and we lose all the tax revenue from the $75 to $100 a round that each person plays. So we lose money when they have a tournament. So that point being made, I think it has to be forceful, but I think it has to be noted somewhere that you have conflicting documentation where some people are read it one place. I didn't know that information. I just read this, so you know, I can put the top of my head back on after it blew off. But I think we want to be very clear to the citizens that we are not subsidizing or picking and choosing businesses. And in light of what Councilman Gassick said, where there's a lot of golf-centric events going on there, we want to be very sensitive to that. The question I have, and I'm looking that this is an event that's in 2017, but some things were deferred, like the music festival, that would also be in 2017. So what timeline were we looking for application, and how far out in the future were we going to approve funds for?
Well, the items that are deferred, the committee will get together in the spring and look at doing a second round of applications if we have funding available for those. Yes, round B.
Okay.
And so those that are saying deferred, we want them to bring them back in the second round of application asks.
Okay, and that's fine. But the last thing I had a comment on, and it goes back to the project was not our focus. How was the determination of the cherry blossom tea, which was kind of always an inward looking thing, and it's from the DuPont Historical Society. How are we saying that that is now a tourist draw?
The numbers show that it's a small turnout, but the numbers show documented proportionally. There's a fair number of people come from outside 50 miles. We're not going to spend $30,000, $40,000 advertising for it, but
50 miles, you say?
Yes. The LTAC committee felt that the level of requests was commensurate with the number of people coming in from beyond 50. Would you agree with that council number?
That's it. Councilmember Corbin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A few questions here. I noticed that in a couple of the comments were made regarding the review of these, that they talked about that they didn't have budget numbers, that they couldn't support some of the stuff, so you asked them to come back, plan B, part B, whatever. And somebody had mentioned there that budget isn't part of the pack. That you don't ask them as part of the application process to have a budget. So is that something that you're going to change and ask for now, since it appears that that's one of the determining factors for approving or not approving?
Yes, we are. Before we have the next round of applications, we're going to be completely revising our application package to be able to provide the committee with the information they felt was needed to make a knowledgeable decision about approving or not approving grants. There were things that they really liked about a lot of the programs here that we've said deferred, but there just wasn't enough information at that moment to answer all of their questions, and they didn't have somebody in the audience who was able to make it to speak on those.
Okay, and I would like the council, at least I would like to see when that's revised, you know, what the application actually looks like. I'd be interested in seeing what that looks like so we know what they're actually being asked to provide. The other thing, I noticed that, you know, that the outward, the 50 mile thing, but a lot of these things, you know, appear to be local. I know that the money comes from hotel stays. So from reading this stuff and hearing everything, I'm assuming at this point that draw for hotel stays is not necessarily the key factor for approving these things. Most of these things probably won't have people spending night in hotels, except maybe some of the golf events. So is there, when you're looking at these to approve, do you look at how long these events are? I mean, like for instance, Clear Blue on Memorial Day, they come in with, start setting up at 7 in the morning and they're done by 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, or whatever. I'm sure that some of the people may stay to eat locally, but, you know, so they look at hours or overnight or, you know, whether the length of that activity will actually incur business to the city.
I think we'd probably have to defer to a community center. You remember that you're talking about what they're thinking about, how they come up with the decision. Perhaps Councilman Westman, as the chair, would like to answer that one.
We basically, just a second, I'm going to help everybody else off again. We basically evaluated each event on the application itself, and the data that was used by the applicant in supporting their application. We tried not to be subjective in trying to add more to that. We had to look at what was being presented. Council, you have in your packet 13 pages of minutes where each of these applications were discussed and what was said, what was evaluated. I suggest before you jump to any of your conclusions when it comes to the final decision making that you look at the minutes, and I think many other concerns would be resolved at that time. And I congratulate staff for providing those detailed minutes. The minutes will, in all likelihood, be reviewed when the state auditor comes in order to ensure that we are taking the proper action on each of these applications. So I appreciate the detail you're getting into it in asking questions, but I do believe many of your questions would be answered if you would take some time and read those 13 pages.
Councilmember Gasser.
I did read the comments on these. My next question is regarding the museum asking for funding and only receiving a few hundred dollars and not have to do with the freeway sign. In particular, what I find troubling is we're told repeatedly that the museum brings in visitors from outside the community. Constantly we hear that, yet they're being denied because the community, it's community-oriented and less outward-focused. And when I looked at the details, I didn't see anything that really explained that. So I find that troubling.
Councilmember Coffey.
Okay, since I've been bumped off a few times.
That's all right.
Evidently, the people who are on the LTAC committee don't have garage sales because I am the best garage saler in Dupont, and I have prolific garage sales. In fact, I have people, a ladies group who comes from Centralia and Chehalis every year to my garage sale. So, yes, don't even talk about my shoes. And, you know, I still have a whole bunch in my closet. But the Holiday Bazaar is a museum at Parks and Rec. I don't understand why that was deferred, because I believe they also made comments or kept track of where the people were coming from that attended the bazaar. Let me see here. Oh, and the Hudson Bay Day advertising, one was put from $6,000 to $2,500. It said advertising will be online only. Does that mean, you know, we have newspapers?
excuse me, as I recall, the committee moved a bunch of advertising money around from different events, conglomerated it, and reduced all of them. And that is the specific advertising online. But the tourism board, they will actually be advertising in different media. So it's not just going to be online. And that's correct, isn't it? It's not correct. Get up. We want it to be right.
Councilmember Weston, please correct me if I'm wrong, but what I remember hearing from the committee was that they'd like the majority of the advertising money that I hope to be granted to be spent on online advertising purchases, primarily because it's so much less expensive, and that's why those budgets were cut.
That was the argument presented.
And my question, though, is will there be absolutely zero advertising for this event except online? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I heard from the committee, is that that was why they were cutting it in half, was that I could, there was more bang for my buck, basically, if I spent online advertising. I mean, I can certainly research print media and see if I can...
No, that's okay. It was a good question, and like I said, I want things to be accurate. I don't want us to have different pages here. Thank you.
Okay. We have, you know, a limited amount of historic sites that are accessible. And the museum, I believe, since we have had more staffed hours there, we have been increasing outside visitors, and I really want to be able to promote that, and if we need more money for the advertising to get people to the museum, then I think we should do that. I guess that was mainly it, because I do agree with Councilmember Gassi that we do need to focus more on the museum and giving it every opportunity to be, you know, people coming in more and more. And as far as the cherry blossom tea, they were sold out this last year. I mean, it was a huge success. And there are groups of women that come specifically for that. So we have to give the museum the tools to expand their outreach. And through the cherry blossom tea, this is a very successful way of doing that.
Okay, seeing no more council comments or questions on the LTAC, before when this comes back up on the agenda again, we may want to look at getting the LTAC committee in here when we have this discussion, since it seems like the council has a lot of... We'll just talk about it later, but seems like there's a lot of council questions. Okay, next on the agenda is my report. We've got several items to cover. For everyone, on the 10th of September from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., that's on a Saturday, we will be having an event at Powder Works Park. We're going to officially open the off-leash area. A lot of people are enjoying that right now. We're going to have our third annual Seahawks kickoff rally. I have contacted the Seahawks organization and reminded them that the last time they had a rally in DuPont, they won. When they didn't have a rally in DuPont, they lost. I'm sure there's a direct correlation between those. And that will be one of the venues that we take to discuss the ALS process. Just we have a large crowd gathered. After they have celebrated dogs and Seahawks, they'll be in the mood for talking about advanced life support. So we're excited about that. We have a couple candidate forums coming up. The League of Women Voters is going to sponsor in sometime late September, early October, a forum in this facility for the Pierce County Council number 6 position. That will be advertised. And then the American Legion on 27 October will be having a candidate forum for our candidates at the county level, that's council and exec. State level, our two representative positions from the 28th district and our senatorial position. So that's an opportunity for the voters of DuPont to actually be in a venue with those candidates. Some of you may have seen on the city and on my Facebook site, we put up, our city administrator found this, that a survey done by the organization Zibia has ranked DuPont as the 7th most successful city in the state of Washington. That's out of the 118 cities with a population of greater than 5,000. They looked at poverty level, median household income, and unemployment rate. In the top 10 cities were Sammamish, Snoqualmie, Mercer Island, Newcastle, Woodinville, Mill Creek, DuPont, Issaquah, Mukilteo, and Normandy Park. I think that's exciting. Those places around our state that are thought of as very desirable to be, we're in the top 10 of those places. Couple that with our third ranking now as the safest city in the state, and that's a testament to all the people that live here, our great staff, our great public safety, and the thriving business community we have. So, that's pretty exciting, and we got 6 places to work on. And now it's time for the city administrator's report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good news in our little piece of the world. Unfortunately, I can't help I-5 and all the distractions that are going to be there this weekend. But Wilmington Overlay Project is finishing up. The striping will be done and complete. We'll have a brand new road by this Friday. Please pay attention to all the news articles, the news TV coverage, the website postings, everything. Last week's traffic with the summer traffic is going to be the same volume, and WASDOT's trying to get the word out. That will help them. They're necking down I-5 from the dome down to almost the mall to 2 lanes starting Friday night until Monday morning. Please avoid it if you can. That's all I can say about that. It's going to be bad, and there's an air show. So please try to find alternate routes. Speaking of routes, projected up there, Councilmember Coffey had asked me to explain what's going on. There's a lot of big trucks, and there's a lot of work on the dirt road there around JBLM back behind Chevron. So what this is in support, this is a logistical support for the Sound Transit Railroad, the Point Defiance bypass that we just went through exit 119. So they've got to have trucks and all kinds of logistics come through. When they first started planning this, over a year ago, and we're going to these meetings and trying to figure out the best way to least impact, we asked them to not come down exit 119 in Wilmington. So they came up with an alternate plan. JBLM stepped in as a good neighbor. So their logistical route will be ringing the golf course on a dirt road. And so they've been improving the dirt road, getting away from these trucks. And they'll be entering in and out of the gate over back by Jiffy Lube, between Jiffy Lube and Starbucks there, the DuPont Realty building. They'll be using that, and they'll be using exit 118 instead of 119. So expect to see that throughout the summer. It should not affect, and will not affect DuPont traffic any. And then I have 2 more things. And Ms. Buck stole my thunder, but that's okay. We'll save some more. On September 16th, there is a moonwalk right here at Sequatchie Creek Trail. And it includes a salmon bake down at the beach this year for the first time ever. So it should be very interesting. We expect 1,500 people to attend. That's another event that's growing over time. And this is the second annual, correct?
No.
Third annual.
We did one in 2014, none last year, so this is the second.
So it'll be the 4th moonwalk in 3 years. And then the last bit of information, I'll be out of the office tomorrow, but in the local area. Thank you.
The mayor stepped out momentarily. However, you can go ahead and proceed with the department reports or other.
Council reports.
Okay. Any council reports? Council member Coffey.
It was a really great weekend. I was really pleased with the turnout for the car show on Saturday and also the Hudson Bay Days at the fire day here. We had I worked on the craft table with the children, and it was a very busy place the whole day with the Hudson Bay Days. Renee Buck really did a great job of building those little corn husk dolls. That was really a big hit. And I have to really say a big thank you to the DuPont Troop, 470 Troop Boy Scouts. They were fantastic. They were helping out by setting up, taking down. They were helping kids do crafts. So I really felt that it was a great weekend.
Councilmember Hilder. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I've gone to the dog park like 5 or 6 times already, and huge success. I've been talking to as many people as I can on there and asking them. They have no idea who I am, and I'm asking them, what do you think about the dog park? What is it big enough? What do you think could be better? Rave reviews universally, people seem to really enjoy it. That makes sense because they took their dog to the dog park. But one thing, and I have a couple questions. If I may, the rules stipulate on the outside of the gate there that each dog must have a license. And I already had a question asked, and actually a family member wanted to come down with mine, so this is 2 instances already. A dog from out of town, I don't know how that would be handled should something happen in the dog park. Are they allowed to be there? I think it's probably the main question. Secondary is what would happen, I guess, liability-wise, if something were to happen.
So let me, the Attorney Justice Murray, I'll let him answer. But generally speaking, if you're in a jurisdiction that requires a license, it should be licensed in or out of town for liability purposes. But you can go ahead and expound on that.
Yeah, in terms of allowing a dog, it would require any kind of license. So if someone was visiting from out of town, they had a license from their jurisdiction, that would be our requirements. We just want to make sure that it's a if nobody else agrees with my necessity, that if you have a dog in the park, you need to get licensed properly.
And then the second question, probably for Gus here, I had multiple people mention the one thing they would do to improve would be a water spigot. Is that a possibility?
When we started out this project, we wanted just to get the plane off the ground, but now we're adding amenities on board the plane, and that will essentially be we're putting together a list of amenities to either auction off or have private donations also buy those items. So that a water point is one of the items, benches, other things like that.
Great. One last bit about the private donations, not necessarily for you, but just in general, a big thank you to the community, business community, private citizens that came together, made this a reality. Councilmember Gassick for your leadership on it. Finally happened, so thanks to everyone who made that happen.
Councilmember Weston. Yes, on Sunday, our church had a 50-member picnic over there at Auto Works Park. And during that time, there were 2 stray dogs within the area. And a dog owner who was there with their dog, a licensed dog, gathered those 2 strays and put them into a smaller area for the smaller dogs, even though they were quite large, and proceeded to call 911. And the officer came within a few minutes in order to answer the call and determined, yes, they were strays. They had one had a collar, one looked like it was ill because it was throwing up and all this sort of thing. The call was made to Lakewood, to Animal Control. control, but a very quick response on the part of our law enforcement there. Neither dog was licensed, and I certainly would support the aspect that if the owners of those dogs, in fact, were local, that notice be given to them to get those dogs licensed so that we can determine the ownership rather quickly. But the officers were on the scene, and there was some debate going on how are they going to get the dogs on over to our kennel at City Hall, but over a period of time that was resolved in the way they went. But very effective.
Councilmember Gessler.
Thank you. I also had the chance to visit the dog park, although my dogs weren't very cooperative and I had to backtrack and get doggy bags because they didn't wait to go potty in the park. But I was wondering, because I didn't see anything, if we are putting up a large dog park sign and a small dog park. It's obvious to me, but maybe not to some.
We originally set it up as having one side being small dogs and large dogs, but I think what we're going into it is having pet owners decide which one they want, because obviously with the when we have the trees and other things, it becomes for a more interesting area. So there are also, we see small dogs in what I call the large dog area. So it also could be, medium-sized dogs that are skittish, I guess, that would go into the smaller area. So the intention at this point in time is for pet owners to self-select which way they would want to go, and not necessarily put up a sign and saying, okay, if you're a small dog, because then we'll probably get into these debates on how small is too small, how big is too big. I do know one of the comments were, where's the entrance? So we're going to be working on putting up a, entrance and arrow sign to that area, and put up some signs saying, hey, close the gate behind you as you go through the south port. So those are two immediate improvements we're looking at here in the near future.
I just have a few concerns about that, mainly because my Chihuahua thinks he's a Rottweiler, and he would love to try to challenge one, and it probably wouldn't end very well. So I would hate to see dogs that are too big and playful in the small dog area, because some small dogs don't know how to handle that very well. So I guess we'll just kind of have to see how it goes. But it looks great. The fencing's awesome. It's easy access. The rules were very visible. There was seating available right outside the park, and I can see lots of things that we can do with that. So I'm super excited about it and looking forward to the grand opening. So thank you.
Right, if there are no more council reports, it's time for department reports. Council members, you have those in your packet. If you have any specific questions for the staff, this is the opportunity. Council member Corbin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In the first part, talking about the sprinkler irrigation information, have we inspected all the irrigation heads? Because I know that some of them are just spraying straight into the air along the beam and stuff like that. So I'm just wondering whether that's been done.
Our process is at the beginning of the season, there is an inspection and essentially to get it out of winter mode. And also we do the same thing, we close it up. But I can tell you my staff is frustrated. Things just break. We do have a contract team that goes out and cuts center drive, greenways and so forth. So as we are notified of sprinkler heads being damaged and what have you, we do make an attempt to correct them as soon as we're able to. But unfortunately, most of these are going off in a day shift work periods. So we're relying on essentially getting notifications on, okay, hey, within a zone, a sprinkler has broken. But I can tell you, things just break on a regular basis, whether it's a person riding a bike over a sprinkler head, one of our contractors are riding over the lawnmowers with a sprinkler head, or let's just say a vehicle pulls off to the side and gets too close to it. So it could be innumerable events that happen. We do have a regular system of following up after it, but it's a system of checks of, okay, is the system working as intended, meaning is the zone operating as intended? So we're not able to keep up on a regular basis, unfortunately.
Okay, is there a email address or phone numbers that you want, like by
next thing. If somebody else sees something that they can call, because like you said, maybe at night you wouldn't know about it.
I'm getting those. The front desk at City Hall receives them. They get forwarded to me.
Okay.
So I get them on a regular basis. Sometimes it's a challenge to describe the location, so then we'll be operating multiple zones to see which of the areas has a broken area.
Okay, thank you. The Parks and Rec Department, we talked about the senior activity. Does somebody have the number of how many seniors showed up for that event?
I do not have the official number, but I looked in during the event and it was probably 6 to 8 at the most. It was very small.
And then the last one in the police department portion where it talks about the animal calls kind of went up by 10. And I'm just wondering, are most of the animal calls lost or stray dogs or animals, or is it incidents that occur because the animal did something to somebody or some other animal?
Councilmember Corp, I'm going to have to look into that, be able to answer that question. I don't have the answer tonight.
Okay, thanks.
Councilmember Miller. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Chief Sheehan, also in the police report, I read about this incident where the officer riding a motorcycle had to switch out into a patrol car before responding to an event. And that was a 7-minute, 30-second response time. Did that trigger some kind of review of how we're utilizing the motorcycle going forward, or I should take that up?
It made me look into it a little deeper to find out what happened and why it happened. And what happened was that the officers were going to a staging area before they responded to the call. So actually, in the end, the motorcycle rider could have gone directly to the staging area instead of going to the station. So it's just a matter of coordination versus the use of the tool, motorcycle versus vehicle.
Okay, so it wasn't necessarily that he could not respond to the scene with the motorcycle.
In the end, actually, one of our vehicles went to the station as well as the motorcycle. Only one of them needed to go. The motorcycle could have gone to the scene instead of the station.
So it just sounds like it was some confusion in the moment.
Yes, people trying to coordinate. There was the call itself appeared to be a high-profile call with a barricaded subject to his arm, but it turned out that was not the case.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to make sure it wasn't an equipment issue. Thank you.
All right, if there are no more questions from Council, Chief, I believe you wanted to make some comments.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, thank you. I just want to go over our alert that we put out last week. So on 8:18 at approximately 4:25 p.m., a 10-year-old female was walking alone on the trail in the 1200 block of Burnside Place when a suspect approached from behind, picked her up, and began to run with her down the trail. The victim fought the suspect and managed to escape, waving him on the arm in the process. The suspect ran off towards Hoffman Hill Boulevard. The suspect was described as a white male in his mid-20s, 5'11", slim build, brown spiky hair, possible facial hair on his chin, green or bright blue eyes, wearing a plain black t-shirt and blue jeans. One arm, the suspect may have a noticeable white mark. I just want to let you know, and the rest of the council and the citizens here tonight, that we are investigating this incident vigorously. We're getting lots of leads from many different people. Some of them are good, some of them aren't so good, but we're following up on all of them. We're developing our own leads at this time, so we have some persons of interest, I'll say. We did a sketch with the victim. We used Marie Oberg, who is a resident of DuPont, but is a forensics expert of the Pierce County Sheriff's Department, and that sketch fits that description that you heard me read tonight, and that will be out tomorrow in the bulletin for the rest of the public and for us to view and use. That's about where we're at this point.
Thank you, Chief. Okay, we have no unfinished business. We have no new business. So it's time for our second opportunity for public comments. The same rules apply. If you would like to comment on anything on or off the agenda, please come to the podium, state your name, address, and limit your comments to 3 minutes.